The internet is. So welcome everybody. We're gonna learn a piece today in the sitter, which is actually what we're pretty much up to in Soul of the Sitter weekly, but it's a special edition because we're under special circumstances, to put it charitably. If you could open in a sitter to the portion, or to Sefer Tehillim, to Tehillim chapter 20. Tehillim chapter 20 will be our focus today. Last week we focused on Tehillim Kuf Mem Bet. And that shiur was recorded. It was uploaded, I believe, to that YouTube channel that I set up just ad hoc. Happy to send out the link again. And, you know, I have a few of these already done. We've previously done Kuf Lamed and various others. So I hope to send them out sort of in a stepwise manner, so that if people want to look them up, learn them, if it could be of help to give chizuk, especially at a time like this, would be really, really helpful, I hope. So let's look at chapter 20. If you're looking in a regular sitter, not in the sitter of David HaMelech, but in a sitter that you have in your home, so you should open up in the sitter every day, the daily tefillah, for those the uninitiated. You can find it right after the second Ashrei. So past Shmon Esrei, then comes Tachanun, then comes the Sefer, the Hotzat and Hachnasat Sefer Torah, then Ashrei. So I don't have an Art Scroll sitter in front of me.
Your pace up.
Someone have an Art Scroll sitter? Want to announce the page in the Art Scroll sitter if you have an Art Scroll, because I know other people have that. Okay.
So tonight
there's one?
Yeah.
Okay. Art Scroll is page 999.
That was if you have the all Hebrew Art Scroll, it's
okay.
64.
What page?
If you have the all Hebrew one.
It's what page is in Arl Hebrew?
64 in the Davening.
64 in the Hebrew English Art Scroll, page 152. And my Koran is up on the shelf. I don't want to waste more time going to get it. Hopefully you found it. If not, look on your phone. Find Tehillim chapter 20. Let's learn a little bit about this parak of Tehillim. It's really important. These are our tools. These are our instruments, especially now with everything going on. It's very important that we try to understand a little bit more deeply what we're learning, what we're reading, and what its significance might be. Like everything else, I could spend 3 hours on this. I have about 25 minutes to say what I can, and after that, I got to run, and I'm sure you have to get back to other things as well. The first thing is, those of us who are trying to learn the Masechet Brachot for Daf Yomi, we already recognize that, in addition to the title, Lamnatzech Mizmor LeDavid, which I'll come back to shortly, but the first line of it, that's sort of the title. Sorry, that's the title in the scripture. You know what I'm going to do? If it's okay with everybody, I hope it's okay. I'm going to mute everybody. And then when people have a question, just sort of raise your hand or whatever it is, so that we can, we can proceed along like that. Nothing personal that I'm muting everybody. There's a lot of background noise. Okay, let's go. So, Yancha Hashem B'Yom Tzara. Yisagevcha Shem Elokei Yaakov. Hashem, we're asking that Hashem should hear you in the time of trouble, an Eitzara, and that there should be defense from the name of Yaakov. V'amar Rabbi Avin HaLevi, the Gemara Masechet Brachot and Daf Samach Dal, the last page of Masechet Brachot. What does it mean? Yancha Hashem B'Yom Tzara Yisagevcha Shem Elokei Yaakov. Why do we mention Yaakov? Elokei Yaakov V'lo Elokei Avram V'Yitzchak. We refer to Yaakov, but not Avram and not Yitzchak. Why wouldn't we say the Elokei HaAvot? Why only Yaakov? Why is Yaakov particularly suited to a reference at a time of trial? Answers the Gemara, Mikan Lebal HaKor Shikanes Be'ovya Shel Korah, the one who is the master of the beam should go under the thickness of the beam. Rashi explains what this means, which is that if you have to take what's called the korah, the beam that you're going to use in order to build something, and you have to move a beam, then you should take the beam that is the strongest. Yaakov Avinu was the one who, quite literally, was the progenitor of all of Bnei Yisrael. That's how we're called. That's how we are. And he was the one who raised up and took the time to raise up the children of Israel. So we're actually asking, according to Rashi, on this Gemara, Yavakesh Aleihem Rachamim. We're asking, as it were, for, like we say sometimes in another context, that Yaakov Avinu should be a Melitz Yosher. That we're asking Yaakov Avinu to be the one to declare to HaKadosh Baruch Hu, we need your help now. If there's a time of Tzara, David HaMelech, who is absolutely the author of this chapter of Tehillim, David did not write every chapter in all of Tehillim, Some of them are ascribed to other people. The Gemara says so. Maseches Bava Basra tells you Moshe Rabbeinu wrote some. Avraham Avinu wrote some. Asaf, the Sefer tells you wrote some. Chizkiyahu and his Beis Din edited them, etc. But this one, Lamotzer Mizmor LeDavid, is right there. Definitely, it's David. So who is David reaching for when he davens? David reaches for Yaakov Avinu. We've learned in other contexts as a shul not too long ago the great connection between David HaMelech and Yaakov Avinu. There are many, many connections between the two of them in terms of the struggles of their life, the sense that they had to go into exile, each of them, from their own families, that they had to live at times in a very dangerous and solitary way. Last week, we talked about Tehillim 142. David is literally writing from a cave, right? That's Yotov Amarat Filah. It's his prayer from inside a cave. That's solitude. That's David running away from his enemies, who happen to be also family members in that case, which is very sad. That's a reality. What happened to Yaakov Avinu? Also had to run away on account of a family member. Also totally alone. And David HaMelech, I can show you this from many different chapters of Tehillim, looking also the Shirei HaMalot, you'll see that some of them actually reference Yaakov Avinu overtly. Why? Because when David davened, David, Malkam Shicha, reached also for a person who inspired him. And that person is Yaakov Avinu. The Gemara, Rabbi Avin Halevi, says, Davka, because Yaakov is the progenitor of Klal Yisrael, who can carry the burden like the Melech? An Av, a father. The king of Israel, when he's in trouble, thinks, who was the most majestic individual in terms of having to carry the load of many people and to realize I'm in a leadership role now and I need help from Hashem? So it's Yancha Hashem Biyom Tzara. We never, ever, ever daven to the spirits, the souls, the memories. We don't do that. It's not Jewish. We simply don't do that. But we do ask that those people be a Melitz Yosha for us. We do this all the time. We get to Beiter. And we're asking, really, that Hashem, in the merit of this person, of this person's legacy, we should be zochim to get out of whatever our tzara might be at the time. Indeed, Rashi, not on the Gemara, but Rashi on Sefer Tehillim, Perek Chaf, tells us, HaMizmor hazeh al shem shayah shalech et Yoav v'chol kol Yisrael milchama. Yaakov Avinu, excuse me, David HaMelech wrote this tefillah when he sent Yoav, his chief of staff. Oh, thank you very much. That's helpful. Whoever just did that. I don't even know. Oh, Joel, thank you. He sent him off. By the way, if you're using Safaria, you can access sometimes the commentary. I don't want to mess you up, but sometimes it's possible to fix it up.
Rabbi, okay, so, you can also put the source sheet up on your desktop and share it with everybody if you want. You can do that for next time.
I don't want to start spending time doing that, but yeah, it's possible that I could.
Next time.
Yeah.
Sorry.
No, it's okay. It's okay. It's fine. So just get back to one thing here. Yeah. Okay. It's just going to be complicated to do. So I'm sort of doing this auditory. You're right. For next week, just try to do it maybe on the screen. I'm happy to send out the McCord also after. It's just not ready for print. I just like dumped in because I'm running thing to thing. So I just did this here, but didn't do the layout really too nicely. Rashi on that first pasuk, Yancha Hashem Biyom Tzara, says, this is what David davened when he sent his chief of staff out to battle. He might not have personally been on the front line. He was sitting at home. I don't want to draw too many parallels, but you're getting the hints here, yeah? He wasn't on the front line of the battle. He wasn't riding side saddle to literally go save people. He wasn't in the hospital, but he was davening for those people. And Rashi here writes that actually, Hayaomi Birushalmi Palel Alehen, and that's what he was trying to do to make sure that there would be, you know, a sense that the people out there on the battlefield would know he's davening for them, and that he would realize that his role still was a crucial one, even from afar, even from a point geographically that was not exactly on the battlefield itself, but its impact obviously was going to have a pretty important result, you could say, for him. There's a Gemara that we had learned together in Sol the Siddur a number of weeks ago. It feels like many, many months ago, but I think it was only a few weeks ago, which was about a pasuk that we say when we finish the Amida. And in order to understand why the significance of this pasuk, the main thing you need to know is it's the pasuk at the end of the 19th chapter of Tehillim, what we call the 19th chapter of Tehillim. And then this is chapter 20. What we're looking at today is chapter 20. The pasuk in question, which the Gemara has a discussion, where should we put this pasuk? The Gemara Masechet Brachot on Daf Tet discusses the reality that we're meant to say a particular pasuk, Yularatzon Imrefiva Gilbila Fanacha Shem Tsuriva Goali. I don't know if you can jump back one chapter, Joel, but it's the last pasuk in chapter 19. Actually, go to the beginning of chapter 19 and you'll notice. Look at the top of chapter 19, Lamnatzeach Miz Morla David. All of these are organized because they're all spoken by David. And in fact, when you go through them, you notice that there is obviously a pattern. Chapter 19, 20, 21 are all Lamnatzeach Miz Morla David. And look at the last pasuk on chapter 19. Yularatzon Imre Fivig and Lilfanach Hashem Tzriva Goali. Have that on the screen. May the words of my mouth and the prayer of my heart, prayer, I would say almost meditations of the heart, which means it's not, oh, that's very nice. It's not just a prayer. I didn't even say it. I couldn't speak the words necessarily. I thought about it. It's the meditations of my heart. The Hegyon Halev is what's going on that maybe was inexpressible. Maybe I failed to express properly. So I hope that that which I said and that which I thought about Hashem should be find favor in your eyes. And we refer to Hashem as my rock and my redeemer, Tsuri v'Goali. The Tsur represents Hashem as the source of stability. That's what it means, the Tsur. And a Goel, of course, is a redeemer from a time of trouble, a time of trial. So the Gemara in Masachet Brachot on Daf Tet has a discussion where it asks the following question. The Gemara says, I don't have time to read the whole thing inside, but once we have this pasuk that we're supposed to recite, Yularatzon Imrei Fi. The Gemara says, well, should it be at the end of the davening or should it be the introduction to the davening? And let me clarify that for those who are less initiated, excuse me. When we say davening or tefillah, it's a general statement about any time a person opens their mouth to talk to Hashem, granted. But there's another tefillah, it's the more narrowly defined tefillah, and that's the Amida, what we call today the Shemon Esrei, the 18 brachas. That we stand before Hashem. That's really the narrow definition of tefillah. And if you want an analogy, I use the same one each time. Someone says, can you give a Dvar Torah? So Dvar Torah can be anything in the world of Torah. But if someone says, can you read a piece of Torah, you know, and could you tell me what's in the Torah reading, we don't mean the Torah reading from Ksuvim. We don't mean the Torah reading from the Daf Yomi. When someone says, what's a Torah reading, narrowly defined, the word Torah means the five books of the Torah. You follow? There's a broader definition, a more narrow definition. It's true with tefillah as well. Broadly speaking, anything you say to Hashem, that's tefillah, unless it's a bracha or some other syntax. That's also a form of tefillah, you could say. But tefillah, narrowly defined, that's the Amida, it's standing before Hashem. So now listen to this. The Gemara on Daf Tet Amud Bet, Yod Amud Aleph in Brachot asks the question. Once we're saying this line, Yularatzon, may my words that I've spoken and my thoughts of my heart, my meditations of my heart find favor, my Hashem, my rock, and my redeemer. Maybe it should be said at the beginning. Why should it be said at the end? The Gemara says, it should be said after the 18 brachas. And it should be said after the 18 brachas. And Rabbi Yehuda says, in the name of Rabbi Yehuda Braid, Rabbi Shimon ben Pazi, Hol lo amaro David el la'acha yudchet parshiot. Because this was the last line of the 18th chapter of Tehillim, L'ficha takin rabban l'achar shmona esrei bachot. Why do we say it after our shmona esrei? Because David HaMelech said this line, Yularatzon, at the end of chapter 18. The Gemara says, what? No, hani yudchet yutet havyan. No, when you look in your Tehillim, in my Tehillim, the Gemara already says, that's not the end of the 18th chapter of Tehillim. It's the end of the 19th chapter of Tehillim. So the Gemara says, what you don't realize is that once upon a time, chapter 1 and chapter 2 of Tehillim were one long chapter. And the Gemara is into a proof about why that was so. It has to do with the word Ashrei, but he basically says that chapter 1 and chapter 2 of Tehillim were together, which means that all the numbers of the chapters of Tehillim get shifted up one, which means the end of chapter 19 is really the end of chapter 18. The Gemara says, okay, you know, sort of solve the problem. But what's going on here? First of all, I made the point before, and I'll reiterate it in this context again as well. The number 18 is not just a cute number. It is the gematria chai, and the Gemara elsewhere on Daf Chav Chet, Masechet Brachot, actually has all kinds of ideas about why this number 18 is so significant that it be the number of Brachot and Shemoneh Esrei. And here the Gemara on Daf Tet and Brachot is basically laboring to explain to us that the 19th chapter of Tehillim, what we call 19 today, when David wrote it, it was actually chapter 18. And since he finished with chapter 18 with the words Yularatzon Imrei Fivi Yagin Libi, so too we should finish our 18 brachot, not written by David HaMelech. Our 18 brachot of the Amida were written by Anshei Knesset Hagdola, 120 sages and Nevi'im intermingled a certain period in Jewish history around the time period during Bait Sheni, the Second Temple period. They wrote these brachot patterned after the fact that the Siddur of Klal Yisrael that we have now, written by the Anshei Knesset Hagdola, redacted by them, comes originally from the original Siddur of Klal Yisrael, the Siddur of David HaMelech. Now, one of you, if not all of you, have already figured out the next thing that I'm going to say. How many brachas are there today in Shemone Esrei, actually? In reality, it's not 18, it's 19.
Right.
But really, ideally, we still call it Shemone Esrei. I want to call it Tshah Esrei, because we know that the number 18 is very significant. Why did we have to add a 19th bracha, a bracha that unfortunately is about Jewish people who betray the Jewish people in their hour of need or otherwise, Vilmal Shinim? We added it because we had no choice. But one day, the 19 brachas will be 18 brachas again, yeah? We won't have to daven anymore about the people of Vilmal Shinim. Rav Herschel Schechter Shlita, in one of his Svarim, I think it's the Eretz HaTzvi, makes the point that he sees in the Tosefta, which is a sefer from the time period of the Gemara, that actually at one time in Jewish history, even after they made the bracha of Vilmal Shinim, the brachot of Vilyushalayim Ircha and Etzamach David were actually one big bracha. They were fused together. That's why some of the words sound like they're saying the same thing. Rav Schechter says it could be that they still call it Shemone Esrei after, because really, bracha about Yerushalayim and Etzamach David, building Yerushalayim and Mashiach Tzidkenu's arrival, were once one. So they maintained the 18 brachas. Now today it's 19. We look in our Tehillim. Actually, now Yul Ratzon is the end of the 19th chapter of Tehillim. Now, we don't know exactly at what point the split came in Sefer Tehillim to make chapter 1 and chapter 2 into two separate chapters, as opposed to them being one. But isn't that interesting? Our Siddur is patterned after the Siddur of David HaMelech in terms of the number of brachot, the number of chapters, until you get to the line, Yul Ratzon Imrei Fi V'Yon Leib L'Fanecha Hashem Tzri V'Goali. If everyone's with me still, now we're going to come into chapter 20. Because chapter 20, which, again, in the original version was really chapter 19, which comes right after you say Hashem Tzri V'Goali, is explained very beautifully by the Gemara in Masechet Brachot and Daf Dalet Amud Bet, and Rashi there. And this will help us also not only to explain something about Tefillah, but hopefully about Pesach as well. Rabbi Yochanan says, the Amar Rabbi Yochanan, Ezu ben Olam Haba, who is a person who has a share in the world to come? And he answers, Zasomer Geulah Tefillah Shel Arvid, a person who connects redemption and prayer. Or to say it in our parlance, Baruch Ata Hashem, Gaal Yisrael, Hashem Sotayitachu Fi Agit Hilatecha. To be somach geula to tefillah today is exactly why when we'll be back in shul, we'll do it this way again, God willing. According to most poskim, one does not say amen to the bracha Gaal Yisrael. When the shliach tzibur gets to Gaal Yisrael, it says Baruch Ata Hashem, either trails off Gaal Yisrael, or as I've asked, people will just say the bracha out loud, the whole bracha, Baruch Ata Hashem Gaal Yisrael, and then everyone should start Hashem Sfatat Yivtach. If someone would say amen, so yeshem ilismach, for sure that you could say amen, but generally most posts can maintain you do not say amen to that bracha. Why? Because of this Gemara Masechet Brachot. It's crucial that a person recite the davening that they're reciting right after they've referenced Geula. B'tchila Omer, at the beginning, a person says, of the Amida, a person says, this is the same Gemara, Hashem Sfatat Yivtach, Ulvasof, who Omer, at the end, he says, Yul Ratzon Imrei Fi. So the Gemara says, well, then, aren't you splitting between Gaal Yisrael and Hashem Sfatai Tiftach? No, says the Gemara, because Chazal told you to say the words Hashem Sfatai Tiftach Ufiyagit Latech at the beginning of the Amida. Once you have to say that and the sages put that in, that's not an interruption. That's the beginning of Shemoneh Esrei, which is why I've tried to impress on whoever I can, politely and nicely, the Amida begins with the word Hashem. Hashem, this was the view of Rav Yosef Levi Soloveitchik. Shemoneh Esrei begins not with Baruch Ata Hashem. It starts Hashem, Sfatai, Tiftach, Ufi Yagidatecha. Ah, it's just a pasuk. Just a pasuk. It's a pasuk from David HaMelech's Siddur from chapter 51. Chazal instituted it. Now listen to what Rashi says. And hopefully this will bring everything together that I've said so far, but this whole issue with the number and how many. So Rashi says the following. It's true at night, and it's true in the morning, that we have to be able to have the sense that we're reciting the declaration about Geula and then go straight into Tefillah. We know this, Zasomel Geula Tefillah, you're a Ben Olam Haba, you're a person associated with a share in the world to come. Rashi says it's true at night, and all the more so in the morning. Why? Because the main redemption from Egypt took place in the morning. As it says in the Torah, and the pasuk reads, "Mimacharat Pesach, Apasach, Yatzu b'nei Yisrael." After Pesach, which means the 14th of Nisan, on the 15th they left. Usmuchat, usmichat, and here's the key line. So listen, if you pay attention to nothing else, this is what you need. Punchline: Usmichat geula tefila. The notion of being somach geula to tefila, Ramza David b'sefer Tehillim, is hinted at by David in the book of Tehillim, where dichtiv, because it says Hashem tsuri v'goali. End of chapter 19. And Joel, if you could scroll up to the end of 19, the beginning of 20. V'samichle, the beginning of the next chapter, Ya'ancha Hashem b'yom tzara. May God answer you on the day of distress. What Rashi explains is that it is crucial to realize that when one says the words, Yul ratzon imrei fi v'yom l'fanach Hashem tzuri v'go'ali, when you've said tzuri v'go'ali, you've mentioned ge'ula, the next word out of your mouth should be a word of tefillah. So therefore, people have asked many times, and it's a good question. I can't answer the whole thing now, but at least part of the answer is, I just said Ashrei previously in my davening, in Shachris. I said it already. I said a beautiful kavanah. I tried my best. I'm going to say it again now. It's like 8 minutes later. It's 12 minutes. I got to say it again, Ashrei. Why am I saying Ashrei again? If we understand chapter 20 of Tehillim, where it's placed in the Siddur, as actually, you could call it a very miniature Shmoneh Esrei. Not 18 brachas, not Shevach and Bakasha and Hoda'ah, but it is an encapsulation of a person saying, I'm in distress, we're in distress, I'm davening for the people on the front lines, and Hashem, I know that you'll send whatever you're going to send to help us is going to come from right here from Yerushalayim. David was standing in Yerushalayim. From Yerushalayim, Yer HaKodesh, Shlach, Ezrecha Mikodesh, and he's giving this this idea to the soldiers on the battlefield, whether they can hear him or not. He's trying to tell them Hashem will send his help for you from the place of sanctuary, which is the place of sanctity, rather, of Kodesh, of Yerushalayim, Yer HaKodesh, and from Tzion, from that actual spot on the globe with Kedushat Makom, more than any other, the place of the Makom HaMikdash, the Har HaBayit. From there, Yisodeka, Hashem will help you to draw strength. Every Jew should draw strength from Yerushalayim, wherever they may be found. Now, if we understand this, then you understand why he's saying Ashrei again? Because you're saying another tefillah now. It's not an actual other tefillah, literally Shmoneh Esrei, Amida Lifnei Hashem, but it is a form of bakasha that has to be preceded by a form of getting myself ready. It's like a miniature Pesukei Dezimra is saying Ashrei a second time. Why? Because I'm about to make a big ask, Hashem. And that is, Ya'ancha Hashem b'yom tzara zekev Hashem Elokei Yaakov. That's why, by the way, on days that are joyous, we skip Lam Natzeach Mizmor LaDavid. How could you say it's something about a day of distress on a day that is already well known to be a day of simcha for Klal Yisrael? So we don't say it, we skip it. Some people connect it always to Tachan. If you skip Tachan, you skip that. That's not been a Megad of Arshul. And Nusach Ari does it that way, etc. But what I'm trying to explain here is that this chapter 20 is so crucial. It's a linchpin because it comes on the heels of the words, Yul Ratzon Imrei Fi V'Yigon L'B'Lefnecha Hashem Tzuri V'Go Ali. Now I'm asking you, Hashem, in my day of distress, help me. Being somech geula to tefillah. And this is how the halacha works, actually. This is the Gemara in Brachot Daf Dalet Amud Bet. This is actually what we're meant to do halachically, to be somech geula to tefillah, both at night and especially in the morning. And this is a period that we're up to now. And we're going to have to try our utmost this year to be somech geula to tefillah. I have 3 minutes left. Let me try to use them wisely to share with you a few other things. Amar Rabbi Levi in Vayikra Rabbah, Kol tovot ubrachot v'nachamot shekadosh baruch hu ati liten l'Yisrael einan ela mitzion. All of the goodness, all of the blessings, all of the consolations that Hashem, that HaKadosh Baruch Hu will give to the Jewish people, they all come from Tzion. How does he know? Yishlach Ezrecha mikodesh. There are other themes going on here, of course, in this chapter. We don't have time to see all of them inside. You can read them in English and find commentaries. There are commentaries aplenty for each of these psukim. Right, the idea of we're actually putting, as it were, the name of Hashem is on our flag. We don't have insignias. We have ultimately we have insignias too. But the point is, we have Hashem is our flag. We Hashem Elokeinu Nidgol, and we're davening. Hashem should fulfill all of our davening to the people on the front. All of the desire, the requests that you have. And the notion that other nations are relying just and exclusively on their military prowess, we're not going to. We're going to mention Hashem's name. Do you think for a minute that David HaMelech didn't actually have an army with armaments, with chariots, with people, with bows and arrows and catapults? Of course he did. Of course he did. It's not a contradiction in terms. It's not an either or. Either you're going to daven or you're going out to the battlefield. Hashem wants us to do both. This is the message of all of the Nevi'im from start to finish, right up, right from the very beginning. This is already from Avram Avinu, in my view. It's pretty proof positive. He needed to get an army together. He did it. He had to fight a good battle. He did it. We have our battles we have to fight, and they may take different forms. The enemies may look different. They may not be human beings, but certainly an enemy at that. Last thing. Hashem Hoshia HaMelech Ya'anenu B'yom Koreinu. The Radak says, the last pasuk here in this chapter was the pasuk that was the battle cry on the battlefield. Hashem, save us. May the king answer us on the day that we call. Right? And now that it said, V'anachnu B'shem Hashem Elokeinu Nazkir, we will call out in the name of Hashem. What was that? Hashem Hoshia HaMelech Ya'anenu B'yom Koreinu. And who is the Melech? Obviously, it's Hashem. The Melech HaOlam. And it's in his hands to be able to save us. And the more we can declare HaMelech, and I spoke about this last week in one of the Divrei Chizuk, about crowning Hashem, even at this time, to be able to declare HaMelech. And I connected to this Pasuk. And I connected for you, please, in your Siddur, after you say the Psukim on the Ketoret, for those who can, to say the sections from Chazal there, if you have the time, I know not everyone does, to say the Psukim, Hashem Tzivaku Imanu Miskavalanu Elokei Avako Sela, three times. There's that word, Elokei Yaakov Sela, same thing, David speaking. Hashem Tzvakot Hashem Demuter Bach, and then Hashem Hoshia HaMelech Ya'anenu B'yom Koreinu. The Malbim, just say the last sentence, is the Malbim says that this last pasuk is actually the subject of the entire Ma'amar. And that when we're calling out to Hashem, we're calling out, really, Lamnatzech Mizmor LeDavid. We're saying to Hashem now, Hashem, this is what the king, David HaMelech, who saw himself not as a king, but as an Eved of yours. So we're invoking, not just as David invoked the Zechut of Yaakov Avinu, we're invoking the Zechut of David HaMelech. And we're reciting the tefillah of David HaMelech. When we call you Hashem, the king, we are asking that you should save us in tefillah on account of, the Malbim writes, Be'ad HaMelech David, in the Zechut, in the merit, Be'ad HaMelech David, for his sake. Anenu HaMelech David, Lemor Hashem Hoshia. It's almost as if we're saying that we want David HaMelech to also be crying out to Hashem, Hashem Hoshia. And we recognize that we're not going to just have our trust exclusively in the Chayil and not the Koach. Rak Yeshua Hashem, only in the salvation of Hashem. Kichein haya shehashem hoshio levado. That in the end, David HaMelech recognized very obviously that HaKadosh Baruch Hu was the one who saved him each and every time. And Kainti Alanim, so may it be for us in this very trying time that we find ourselves. I hope this is somewhat helpful for everyone. I'm going to sign off because it's an incredibly busy day. But I thank you all for joining. Let's see what we can do to join again next week at this time at 9 o'clock. Haba Alein Latova. I don't know what's coming in 5 minutes, let alone next week. But I hope people can take this tefillah now. And to say it, I asked 8 chapters of Tillim be recited every day if people can. One of them is in the davening. It's this one, chapter 20. So it's 20, 23, 31, 91, 121, 130, 142. I'm going to send it out again later if that's helpful for people to have it. I wish everyone a great day and much great chizuk. All the best.